Anybody else hot? Yeah. Call me. Yeah, I'll text you. Hang on. Does anybody feel the Holy Spirit?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, here we are at the end of this series called Riding On. You know, in the last couple of weeks, we've had, the snowstorm of 2014 last Sunday. Right. I'm glad we missed it. I'm not complaining. But like I was saying the last 2 weeks, Riding On is a series that was based on not just us being able to overcome and to move on with perseverance from things, but also we'd spent the last few months really vertical, talking about a discipleship in the Spirit, fellowship in the Spirit, worship in the Spirit, prayer in the Spirit, servicing, service in the Spirit. We were so heavenly minded, we were no earthly good for a little bit there. I'm just kidding. But we brought it down a little bit horizontally for the fellowship so we could learn how we can become spiritually fit followers of Christ. If I could just talk. So, has anybody seen my clicker? Oh. Somebody keeps getting in. Whoever thinks they're cleaning this, you're not helping. I've got a filing system like my dad's, and it's not good. So, okay, thanks, Danny. He took the heat no matter what. So no matter what your circumstances, situations, we talked about, is there a friendship you've had that's gone south, you just can't seem to get a handle on? It could be a health issue, it could be a marriage issue, it could be a financial issue, it could be a death in the family issue. But the answer's right here, if it'll just do it. Get up, mount up, and ride on. Say it again. You see, the Lord, He lets us come by the still waters, Psalm 23. But in Psalm 24, He says, lift up your head. We've got to carry on. And so there is a time where we have to what?
Get up, ride on.
I wasn't going to say this, but there's by popular demand, and there's somebody in the room trying to write a song to it. So when I point to you, say this, okay? Have you ever been tripped up, slowed up, or stowed up? Have you ever been knocked down, put down, brought down, toned down, and then you stayed down?
Get up, man, up,
have you ever been slammed? Have you ever been jammed? Have you ever been crammed?
Get up, man, up,
okay. Whoa. Back off on that caffeinated coffee, Danny. But it's true. There is a time where we are to get up and go on with our calling, with our purpose. Spreading the gospel. And part one was called Riding On with Purpose. Was anybody here? I'll make it short. It isn't about you. It's about Him. So whenever we think it's our purpose, it doesn't work out. Even starting a ministry, if God isn't in it, it will fall flat. You'll end up discouraged. And we talked about the overarching purpose that God has for us. It's to love others, to share with others, and to serve others. So it's love others the way God loved us. It's hard to do. Share our faith with others. That's carrying the gospel. And then serve others. And that's the overarching purpose. You know, we kind of learned also to seek His will, His purpose, His timing. Waiting on the Lord. Boy, isn't that a tough one. Waiting on the Lord. And so many scriptures tell us to wait on the Lord. So, the fruit of the Spirit, that first week, I would not ask Brenda to come up here and do this, but so I'm not. She already gave me the look like I was testing the water. I know when to pull it back. And I won't do it because I can't do it. I forgot it now. But I did the sign language thing to the fruit of the Spirit in part one as well because I was watching her work on it, and then she got sick.
Yeah, she's still sick. Doris, do you know it? Okay. In a few weeks, when they get done with the Beth Moore study, I'm going to have everybody from Bible study come up. Everybody excited about that? And we're going to sign the fruit of the Spirit, okay? So then we went on to faith and riding on with faith. And basically, we can't go into the whole message, but just in an overview, we talked about the three levels of faith. Weak faith or unanchored faith, which is kind of categorized with a lot of people say a new believer, but I've seen new believers that are just on fire for the Lord. I mean, they got more faith than anybody else. So I kind of put in there an immature believer, but also you can put in here an unbeliever. You're going, really, Frank? Yes. I'm your witness here. Before I knew the Lord, I could look at the stars and say I knew that there was a God. I just never met him. And when I'd heard about Jesus, I'm going, hey, that kind of makes sense, Savior and all that. But I didn't know him. And so it can be when it's in your head and not in your heart, and that's an unanchored, weak faith or an immature believer, and you're just wavering around. Level two is strong faith. And I kind of told y'all last week, I kind of put most people that I'm looking at in this range because this is a growing faith or a reaching faith. And you could be a believer for 40 years and all of a sudden you're hungry. You're hungry for what this has in it. Anybody can testify to this?
Yes.
Suddenly the light bulb turns on. It's like there's been a power outage for the first however many years. And then the light's on and you want to know everything that you can possibly know. And in this stage of faith, you also start getting the fact that it's not a name it or claim it kind of faith. You know, God specifically wants prayers that he answers to be within his will because he's got a higher purpose. Amen? So think of the stoplight that I talked about last week. Green light would be he's answering your prayer right now. Yellow light is wait. Oh, I hate wait. And then red light is no. You mean God would say no? Hey, if God hadn't have said no to me, I'd have so much stuff that I wouldn't even need him. You know what I mean? So he wants to keep us lean for a reason. Sorry, I said lean. Who made that taco pie? That was good. I was telling Brenda about it, but I didn't know what to call it. So that would be a strong faith. And then there's what's called a great faith. And if you're looking at the gifts, you know, the different gifts, this is the gift of faith kind of. You know, this is the person who, no matter what's happening, you go to them and they go, hey, it's okay, God's got it. It's an unwavering kind of faith. It's a trusting faith. Now, let me break something to you in case you're thinking, okay, I hope I'm in level two and I can stay there. You're probably not. I call this elevator faith. Have you ever been, hey, Calvin, remember when we went in that elevator down at the Hyatt Regency? Anybody ever been down there? Remember the Skies restaurant? I don't know what the occasion was, but it was something big because I'd never been to town before. I looked like Jethro. I had a rope for a belt. And we went to the Hyatt Regency and got in that elevator, and it wasn't like a hospital with three levels. This thing, how tall is it? Yeah, that's tall. Well, if we get in this elevator, and there's other people in there, and Calvin and I do this, we're ornery. And I said, Calvin, did you ever see that movie where the cable was just ready to break? And that woman, her eyes got this big, and she says, you shut up! I don't even know how to categorize that faith. It was below weak. But this is what I call elevator faith. I think you can be at level three and go to level one as soon as something happens. You know what I'm talking about? If anybody's holier than thou here, please leave the room because you're not going to like what I've got to say. You can be at level three. You're like, hey, God's got his hand on me. And something happens, and it can be anything from a death in the family. I mean, it can be anything to shake your faith. And you don't only go to level one like in an elevator. You don't only go to the ground floor, Doug. You can go to the basement. Yeah, and it opens and it's black and there's just stuff stored there. It's dark. So don't think that these are levels we achieve and stay there. Now I'm going to move to level three. I hope, you know, Now, I told you last week, I believe there's a fourth level, and this is a level of faith like Jesus Christ. You know what I'm saying? This is a level of faith that's unbelievable. It's I call it the greatest faith. It'd be a supernatural faith that where people are raised from the dead kind of faith. You know what I'm saying? But can we ever catch a glimpse of that? Terry, we were talking about Peter walking on the water, and I just saw that Son of God movie, and when the guy who portrayed Peter, when he stepped out, his face was just, I've got this, I'm doing it, woo! And as soon as the lightning and the thunder, and he looked down, he didn't only go down, he went down. He went down and was struggling. So that's the elevator faith that we got. He went from level 4 to the basement. So don't think it can't happen to you. But the thing is, be prepared for that. Know the promises of God. So you're not caught in the basement going, is God even real? Does God even love me? Is he even out there? You can go to the basement with your elevator faith and still have faith that God's got it. You're just in a place where you gotta take a breather. And then guess what you have to do after that? Get up, mount up, ride on. Okay. Now we're to part 3, riding on with fellowship. I wanted to give you a definition of fellowship right from the Webster's Dictionary, because it's pretty good. It says, a group of people who share common interest, that's pretty good, and share goals. Sound like us? Goal, getting to heaven, having crowns to show something, who share experiences. You know, we're always going, hey, I've been there, done that. I know how you feel. How about the experience of accepting Christ? We share that, don't we? Being set free, feel the shackles come off, the weights come off, or experience views. So it's common interests, goals, experiences, and views. Well, this week, some of us were at a regional pastor's gathering, just happened to be in a barbecue place. I love them when they happen there, instead of some old empty room. And John Hoppler was in town, and he defined it like this. He said church, but I changed it to fellowship. A fellowship is made by, this is it, the beliefs we hold, the missions we share, and the relationships we value. So tonight we're talking about fellowship. The fellowship, the body of Christ, okay? So I want to take us right to the beginning. Acts 2:42. With all the churches there are out there and all the different denominations, and sometimes people get confused and they're trying to weed through everything. That's why we're non-denominational. It helps right off the bat. But if you want to know how we structured Open Range Fellowship, we're an Acts 2:42 church. We just try to keep it simple. And this is, if you turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 45, I know it's small print. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions and gave to anyone who was in need. So you see there that they were getting into the Word of God, right? And they were getting into fellowship with each other. And when you get to the part where they sold all their properties, I need to see you after the service. No, I'm just kidding. In the modern day church, I'm not going to get anybody to sell their property, right? So we have the tithe or the love offering that keeps the church going. Also, there's portions of everyone's tithe here that goes to the mission fields as well. So we try to keep a balance and to the needy as well. So that's how you keep a balance now. At this time, it was very communal. This is the first church. They were called the followers of the way. And that's why the drill team's called riders of the way. Because Jesus is the what? The way. And the truth and the light. Like that. So let's read on, because this is really my point here in 46 and 47. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their numbers, to their number daily, those who were being saved. Now, who wouldn't want to be in Acts 2:42 church? To be able to eat together and say, man, the taco pie, you know what I'm saying? The shepherd's pie, I've got them each into the room. But it's more than just the fellowship. They were studying the Word of God. It's the five dedications that we talk about, being dedicated to discipleship, fellowship, worship, prayer, and service. Keeping those things in some kind of a balance so there's a holistic approach to it. And the thing that really stokes me is, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Isn't that awesome? If you have a church where nobody's being saved and nobody's being baptized, what is the purpose? What is it? Is that fulfilling the Great Commission? That's why I love to see all the young people in the room. I was trying to get some of the young people up in the choir. Yeah, I see heads going down back there. But without the young people, hey, like I said, we can just rent out this arena for a scooter store. Come here and rent your scooter. I'll give demonstrations. New life has to be breathed into everything, especially the church. And you do that by leading people to Christ, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Anybody got an amen?
Amen.
Okay. That means I can move on. So I walked in Wednesday morning. We meet and go over a few scriptures, do the radio show. And I walked in, and sometimes when Tony's able to be there, he presides. It's either him or Joe. And he said, turn your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. And I'm going, what? That's what I've been poring over for 2 weeks. Poring over that. Isn't that funny how that happens? Because it's about love. If you turn your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4, go to verse 7 and hold. But right off the bat, 1 through 6, just to be in context of what we're talking about here, John's warning the new church, and a lot of these churches are house churches. They didn't have big buildings, okay? They're meeting in people's houses. And he's warning them about false teachers, about wolves. And what he's warning them about is people that will try to get in there, not just to disrupt, but get in there to teach. I mean, our doors are open to anybody. But they were trying to get them in there to teach. And he's saying, test the spirits. And he's going over it and over it and over it. And it gets down to, do they say that Jesus Christ is the Lord Jesus Christ? The Lord Jesus Christ. Is he Lord? You know, the Lord Jesus Christ in its fullness, there's lots of churches that talk about Jesus. They'll even have the name on the marquee. And you know they're a cult. And you're going, how come that can be? Or they can even say, Lord, Lord. Scripture says, not everyone that says Lord shall be saved. So it's the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ in the fullness of the name. Lord means he's the deity of Christ. He's God. Second person of the Godhead. We talked in Bible study how he was here all through the Old Testament. An angel of the Lord, different places. He was here at creation. Lord. The Lord Jesus. Jesus is the man part. That's us. Jesus was a common name at the time. You know, it's like John or Steve or Ken. No, you know what I'm saying? It was a common name. It wasn't, oh, Jesus is here. Matter of fact, at the time that Jesus' ministry was going on, there were lots of people called Jesus that said they were the Messiah. Did you know that? Look up the historians of that time. It's pretty interesting. How many? That's why Caiaphas said, hey, don't they all say they're the Messiah? Don't they all say that? All the Galileans that say that they're Jesus, the Messiah. So Jesus said, hey, when I come again, there'll be people that'll say, hey, I'm Jesus. I'm Jesus. I'm Jesus. I'm the Messiah. Have we not seen that in our age? It's always been there, but boy, it's getting pretty ramped up now. Getting pretty ramped up. So he warns us of all those things, but this is where we land in verse 7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Okay, what this is really saying, I know it's repetitious about God is love, but hey, if you don't get this, that the character and nature and essence of God is love, you've missed it. God is love. John's just not saying this for the heck of it. God is love. But what you see here is when you're trying to identify a false teacher or false prophet, and you're supposed to test the spirits in a few verses before, what you usually find, and you don't maybe not find out right off the bat, but it will come through, is that they don't necessarily love. There's motivation behind what they do that's not good. It's impure motivation. Or you'll find out that they've got a problem with other cultures, or they're racist in some way. Things that aren't indicative of what you would think of as God's kind of love. So when you find some group of people that do love, Christians that do love, and they do love the Lord Jesus Christ, does it mean they're perfect? No. But they do love. And love covers a multitude of sin. That wasn't just thrown out there either. So we can trip up, we can do things wrong, not meaning to, I mean, but just, hey. But if your motivation is to rule over something or teach or do something, and your motivation is for power, for money, for anything that's impure, and you don't have love, you don't have God, is what this says. It's a shocker. People don't like to hear it. They don't like to hear it. And people that constantly rattle on other cultures, you know, it's okay to be concerned about what's happening in the Middle East, but hey, don't rattle on the Muslims. Let's pray for them. You know what I'm saying? And it's one thing to say, hey, the Buddhists are, my gosh, there's 100,000 gods. It's crazy. Let's get them. No, let's pray for them, that they'll see the one true God. If there's a racist bone in your body, please get on your knees and say, Lord, take it from me, because it's not love. God is colorblind to all the races. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation. Am I making anybody uncomfortable or mad? Please, it's from this book right here. God is love, and we're to love each other. And then it goes on. You know, wait, there's more. In verse 9 and 10, it says, this is how God showed his love among us. So listen up. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Does that sound a lot like another verse of John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is one of the verses that led me to Christ. I'm going, hey, if that is real, I want some of it. You know what I mean? And then it goes on to say, the atoning sacrifice for our sins. I'm here to tell you, and to tell anyone listening at home, that Jesus Christ is the ultimate substitutionary atoning sacrifice for the sins of the world. Period. There's no other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by him. You can stone me, you can kick me, you can drag me from my own dually. I took the ball hitch off, just in case. But we have to start proclaiming truth, and let's keep it foundational. Let's don't squabble about the secondary issues in Scripture. Let's love each other. But when it comes to the foundational issues, Jesus Christ is the ultimate substitutionary atoning sacrifice for the sins of the world. When he said it was finished, it was. Nothing added to, nothing taken away. You can't change it. You can't buy, beg, borrow, steal salvation. It's by grace. It's a gift of God. Through what? Faith. Faith. Remember the elevator faith? Are you ding, ding, ding up or ding, ding, ding to the basement? Just asking. But wait, there's more. Verse 11 and 12. Dear friends, since God so loved us. Now listen up to this. This can be a flyover verse. Since God so loved us, we ought to love one another. Pause there for a minute. This is groundbreaking. This is earth-shattering. People should be on the street corners with newspapers saying, extra, extra, read all about it. God so loved us, we should love others. You wonder why it isn't? Because we live in a self-centered, selfish society. It's all about us. But when you grasp the fact, and I love how it says this here, it's a mind blower of how it's worded here. Since God so loved us, we also ought to love others. Well, aren't we supposed to love God? Well, yeah, it's the greatest commandment, okay? It's the greatest. He's taking us past here. He's saying we're past that, church. He loved us first, okay? We just read that too. And we should love him with all of our hearts, minds, souls, our strength, all that. I might have got that mixed up, but it's the essence of it. Everything we got, living sacrifices to a righteous and holy God. But here he says, since God loved us, we should love others. But he's coming to a point here. He's making a God point. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us. And his love is made complete in us. He's saying if we love others, they'll see God in us. Nobody's seen God. If they're going to see God, they're going to have to see it in us, right? And sometimes we're ugly. We're like that horse with his head up, yanking at the bit. It's true. I call it the ugly face. Wildfire doesn't have it, but a lot of horses do. And they're just pulling against the bit. I want my way. I don't want good headset. I don't want anything except to be turned loose and do what I want to do. Live for today, for there might not be a tomorrow. We need to let people see God through us, is what he's saying here. I had something come up earlier in the week where I don't know, I can't even explain what happened, but one of the women here in the church had said something to me that was so grace-filled about something else. I'm really not making sense here, so let me just cut to the chase. She said something that was so grace-filled, I said, that's the heart of God. That's thinking about others way more than yourself or really anything. It was the heart of God. I saw God in her, and people need to see God in us. Is that simple enough? I get the crayons out here in a minute. God so loved us that we need to love others. But they need to see him through us. But sometimes we are ugly, aren't we? Sometimes we're selfish. Sometimes we're full of just, you know, it's kind of like toothpaste, you know. You squeeze it out and you just can't seem to get it back in the tube. You say things you shouldn't have said and you can't take them back. And in the church, and the same with gossip. Why do you think gossip's listed next to homosexuality? It's a sin. And there's things that are said that are traveled and people repeat it different or intentionally repeat it different to make their position look good. Relationships are damaged, but let me tell you, God's truth usually always comes through. But it could be avoided if we just had the heart of God. Amen? Amen? And tried to avoid it. So we're created to live in community. Now, we're all different a little bit in that community piece. Some people don't need as much community as others, if you know what I mean. Some need more solitude than others, and some need people all the time. But we're all still within that range. We are born to live in community. We're born to live, and we're reborn to live within the fellowship, the body of Christ, all the different parts, heads, feet, toes. I don't know if bunions is part of that or not, but I think I'm getting one. But you know what I'm saying? There's the body of Christ has many members, and they're all important. They all have a function. And we need to be encouraging each other, not discouraging each other. If we want to ride on in fellowship, we need to ride on with love, and we need to ride on with grace, and we need to ride on with forgiveness, and we need to ride on with the Spirit rising up in us. During worship practice, I was saying, Lord, you know, send your Spirit and fill us. And I was thinking, that's not really correct. We've got His Spirit. We suppress His Spirit. And we fill ourselves with us and stuff and TV shows and whatever it is. And it's just stuff. We need to empty out us, fill with Him, and then pour forth. For those of you in the Beth Moore study, you think that sounds familiar? I'm a closet Beth Moore fan. I watch everything that she has. I think she's an anointed teacher. And she says, empty out, fill up, pour forth. That's the cycle. It's kind of like I say about discipleship or Bible studies. You can know the Word of God and never share the gospel. You really can. You can. I know it seems crazy, but you can. You can know everything about this book and keep it to yourself if you want to. But it's not God's design. He wants us, even if we only have one verse memorized, John 3:16, surely you can come up with that, to give somebody hope. Hope. So fellowship, I started this series, and I want to end this series with Philippians chapter 2, if you want to turn there. And I know there's thousands on thousands of fellowship verses, and there's probably your favorite fellowship verses. We're not going there. Because we could actually do a 10-week series on fellowship. Verse 1 and 2. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from His love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, make my joy complete. Remember the word complete. By being like-minded, having the same love, being one in the Spirit, and of one mind. Think about what we just read. This is Holy Spirit inspired. Does anybody doubt that the Holy Spirit inspired the Bible? Okay, then this is God speaking to us. And you read these verses in different places in your walk, and they impact you in different ways. Have you ever noticed you can read something, hey, I've read that thing a million times, and then boom, hey, that just opened my eyes. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, has anybody got any encouragement from that? Is there times in our lives where we kind of lose that? It seems like the fire dies down. Maybe you're not so encouraged about being united with Christ. Maybe things aren't going your way. Maybe the prayers aren't being answered just like this. But if we have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from His love, pause there. We've all felt the comfort of His love if you're a believer. Is there times where maybe you don't? Let me tell you, that's the faith elevator going straight down. You don't want to take that ride. If any common sharing in the Spirit, this is back to the fellowship. Have you ever met someone and it's just like your spirit identified with them? I know we do it here in Potluck all the time. A new person comes in, it's like, don't I know you? No, you don't. Maybe they just moved here from Texas or somewhere. But there's an identifying in the Spirit. Hey, we've got the same God. Hey, we got the same hope. Hey, we've got the same rewards. Whatever. There's a common sharing in the Spirit. If any tenderness or compassion, hey, is your heart hard? is the tenderness. Do you need a little bit of tenderizer? God's got a tenderizer. It's one of those hammers with the things on it. Any tenderness or compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded. We're back to the fellowship definition, aren't we? Like-minded, having the same love for each other. Hey, it's unconditional as we can get. Being one in the Spirit and of one mind. Okay, this is the plan, guys. We're going to, if we were a football team, what would be the plan? We get in the huddle and we go, hey, you go wide with the Bible. Go wide with the gospel. I'm going to cut through here. The devil's going to block us over here. You go that way. There's got to be a plan to carry this Bible clear to the end of the church age and to make an impact for Jesus Christ. And the plan is we have to have the same mind. Have you ever seen a football team that didn't run downfield the same direction? And I don't mean the Chiefs. Or the Browns. No, they're going the same direction, amen? You can't just go running around all different directions. Being like-minded, being one in the Spirit, being like-minded. But wait, there's more. We have to check our motives. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Stop there. We just read about this in 1 John chapter 4. What's your motivation for doing anything? Is it popularity? Is it prominence? Is it position? Is it power? I know there's not too many power-hungry people here, but yeah, that's been a problem in the world, right? What is your motivation? Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Remember, it's not about us. Keep it that way. It's about others. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Don't you love humility? Sometimes it hurts to value others above yourself. For some of you, it's really easy. For others of you, it's really hard. And then there's everything in between, depending on which day it is and where you're at on the faith elevator. Not looking to your own interest, there's another tough one, but to each of you the interest of others. Others, others, others. What's with this? In your relationship with one another, you should have the same attitude as Jesus Christ. Now we're back to the heart of God. The same attitude as Jesus Christ, the heart of God. You know, we're supposed to have the heart of God. When somebody meets us, they ought to see God in us because they can't see Him. Now, once they know Him and have a personal relationship, that changes. They don't have to come to you to see God. Some people say that. Watch out for them. But an unbeliever is only going to see God in you. And then when it comes down to the fellowship and believer-on-believer relationships, do you want to have the ugly face with the bit hanging out of the mouth? Do you want a relationship with God where He's got to put the spurs to you or a German martingale just to get your head down? Or do we want to be able to ride at liberty, trying to do what God wants us to do without any devices, without any crop whips? I'm tired of crop whips. What about you? I've been whipped. The same attitude as Christ. Yeah, Brenda's got a crop whip at the house. I heard that. It's true. So this is the bottom line. It's not a bad thing. So 3 weeks of get up, mount up, and ride on. We talked about our purpose. We talked about our faith. Now we're talking about our fellowship or the body of Christ, the body of believers. How do we become more spiritually fit followers of Christ? How can we apply the things from this awesome God-inspired book to show love to others and let others see God in us? And so here's the answer. Are you ready for it? It's to have the heart of God, but it's also to fly the same direction. Go ahead, Doug. Have you got milk for me? Okay, then you can. Just kidding. Doug just summed it up. Let us live for others. That's where we'll have our joy restored, our faith restored, our purpose clarified. We'll find our giftings there. We'll come alive in Jesus Christ together, not singly. So when you see the geese flying the same direction, isn't it beautiful? Especially when they're heading north, right? I've been waving bye to them. It isn't so pretty when you see the turkeys flying, is it? All different directions, hitting each other and falling down. It's funny, but that's what we do in the church, isn't it? I'm not talking about you guys so much, but the church in general. We're bouncing off each other. We're hitting each other in the face. And it grieves the heart of God. It grieves God that we're not flying the same direction in love and in purpose. It grieves Him. So as we pray this evening, I just want you to be thinking about different places over the last 3 weeks, everything we've talked about, from purpose to faith to fellowship or anything else that seems to be grieving the Spirit in your life, a lack thereof, or something that needs to be tweaked. Maybe you're not running on all cylinders. Maybe you just need an oil change. I don't know. But He wants us to get better if we're going to move from glory to glory to glory. So as we close our eyes, believers, just think about what that could be. Let's close our eyes. Because there's someone else I want to talk to. And it's someone that's still got the shackles of their humanity on them. And maybe they know God's there. They've got a weak faith that says, God, I know You're there. I see the stars. I know that just didn't happen. But I don't know You. And maybe they've heard about Jesus Christ and they're going, man, that would be awesome. I've even seen the movie. I saw the movie, Jesus hanging there, but He's not my personal Savior because all of that knowledge is in my head. It's not in my heart where it needs to be. If that's you here tonight, by the power of the God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, grace is available to you by just saying, Lord, I want to have You. I want You to be my personal Savior. If that's you, just be saying that with me. Lord, I give my life to You. Lord, I know that You were the ultimate substitutionary atoning sacrifice for all mankind. I know it. It's not in my head. It's in my heart. I know it's You, and I want You as my personal Lord and Savior, my personal friend, my personal King, my personal Savior, my personal guide through this crazy jungle we live in. I need You, Lord Jesus, and I also want the fellowship. I want to be in that flock of geese going the same direction, the beautiful others song that Doug sang. I want to be caring about others. I want others to be caring about me. And I want this in the name of Jesus. And let's keep our eyes down. If there's anyone who said yes to Jesus tonight, prayed that with me, just lift a little bit of a hand, just a tiny bit of a hand. Just a little bit of a testimonial wave of a hand. I gave my life to Christ. God bless you. Is there anyone else tonight? give their life to Jesus. Like I said, you could have thought you knew him. You could have seen every book that was ever, read every book that was ever made. You could see every movie. But have you given your life totally over to him, your heart, and received the Holy Spirit? If you did that tonight, there's already been one. Is there someone else? Is there someone else tonight who wants to see the shackles? Is there someone else? God bless you. Is there someone else? The angels are celebrating for the one. Guess what's happening with two? Is there anyone else here tonight? Freedom. Freedom. I see you back there. Freedom. 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 Shackles are coming off. Handcuffs are coming off. Weights are dropping. God bless you. I see you. Is there anyone else tonight in the name of Jesus who wants freedom and wants a home? Anyone else? Oh, Lord, we are so excited about these decisions here tonight. We're excited about you. And we've come alive. The light bulb has come on. We have had oil changes, Lord Jesus Christ. We've had a tune-up here tonight. But wait just a moment. Of the believers in the room, is there anyone that's identified anything that can make them walk leaner, faster, smoother, more in harmony, more in fellowship, more in step? Lift your hand as a testimony. Hands all over the room. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you made the sacrifice, that you loved us first. And Lord, help us to show your love to others. Help others to see you in us. Help us to get the ugly look off of our face and put the goofy grin of joy, peace, and purpose. People of faith, yes, we're on the elevator, but we're trying to stay on the upper levels. Lord Jesus, help us there and protect us from the evil one. Lord, help us to put on the armor of God every day, if not twice, three times, Lord. Let us pray Ephesians chapter 6 over our families. We know the devil wants our marriages. He wants our children. And he wants us to be dummied up and just think about stuff. So, Lord, help us to not think about stuff. Help us to think about you and how we can be better and better and better. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, you guys, when you said you felt the Holy Spirit here earlier, you did. People have been set free here tonight for time and for eternity.